this song this morning came to my mind, and I couldn't get it off my mind. And so we're going to do it this morning. But it's a great testimony. It's a great praise song. Let's just sing to Him. How marvelous. I stand amazed.
How marvelous. How wonderful. And my song shall ever remain.
Catch that line in the second verse. I love it. When I think about it, it never grows old. In the reality, in that verse, the writer says, He took my sins and my sorrows, and He made them His very own. When I think about that, meditate on the fact that Jesus, God, very God, sinless, who knew no sin. The Bible says, He who knew no sin became sin or sin offering for us. And my sins were laid on Him, and your sins were laid on Him. And He suffered the wrath of God in our place. He made our sins His very own. That is an incredible thing. Just thank Him this morning. How marvelous. I stand amazed at the fact that God would do that. That He would extend His grace to us and save us, draw us to Him so that we might become born again. And it never gets old. This morning we're picking up in John chapter 8 in the 12th verse. This is, of course, after the story of the woman who had been caught in adultery. And Jesus is still there at the tail end of the Feast of Tabernacles, and they're in the temple area. And he begins speaking again to the crowd after this incident with the Samaritan woman. And he makes a statement, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Now here Jesus is speaking spiritually, in spiritual terms. And he's speaking of the fact that he is the light of the world. The world oftentimes is described in Scripture or paralleled with darkness, where there's sin and corruption. And he says that he is the light of the world. And the one who follows me will not walk in darkness. And he's speaking of those who would trust him as their Savior. But salvation doesn't stop at the moment of trusting Christ. We then become a disciple of his, and he calls us to follow him. And he said, if you follow me, you'll never walk in darkness. If you're mine, while you're in the world, but you're not of this world, you will never walk again in the darkness of sin, being separated from God because of your sin. And so the Pharisees said to him, "You are bearing witness about yourself. Your testimony is not true." What they were accusing him of was just making up and fabricating a story, if you will, about who he was. And it was required in the law that there must be a witness of the bearing of two testimonies to affirm anything. And Jesus replies to him, said, "Even if I do bear witness about myself, my testimony is true." Now, the reason Jesus could state that was because he is God. And God is not subject to anyone's examination in the sense of what he declares. We find today that in our age today that there are those who question what God has said in his word. And they elevate themselves in a higher place where they think that God's words can come under their scrutiny, making themselves out to be greater than God. We find that very prevalent today in what is called progressive Christianity, where there are those who think that they have the right and the prerogative and the place to examine what God says and question what God says. Who are they to question what God says? And so Jesus is saying, listen, even if I do just bear witness myself, I bear witness in truth because what I say is true. I am God, for I know where I come from and where I am going, but you do not know where I come from or where I am going. Now we know Jesus came from the Father, and he's telling them, listen, you don't know where I came from or where I'm going. And then he says in verse 15, you judge according to the flesh. In other words, you judge according to man's reasoning. You judge according to what man thinks is right. And you think that you have the ability to elevate yourselves again over God and judging. You judge in the flesh. However, I judge, I don't even judge, but even if I do judge, my judgment is true. For it is not I who judge, but I and the Father who sent me. In your law it is written that the testimony of two people is true. I am the one who bears witness about myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness about me. Now, I coming back to this again, of God's judgment. God alone is the one who is able to judge, because God alone is the only one who is in pureness and holiness and righteousness, and his law emanates from him, who he is. And God alone is able to judge. But Jesus says, listen, not only do I judge, but the one who sent me, he judges also. There we have, according to the law, there are two that bear witness, me and the Father, he says. Then the Jews said to him, where is your Father? And Jesus answered, you know neither me nor my Father. If you knew me, you would also know my Father. And so, boy, Jesus just kind of cuts right through to the Pharisees. And he says, you don't know me nor my Father. They thought they knew God. Oh, they knew God's law. They knew God's law, every tit, every tattle, every bit of God's law. But they did not know him. And as I was reading this morning, I thought, you know, we need to be careful that we don't fall into the trap of only knowing God's law, knowing God's word, but not knowing him. You see, it's his word that reveals to us who he is. His word reveals to us his nature, his character, his love, his grace, his justice. The word reveals to us who God is. And at the same time, the word of God reveals to us who we are and our condition. And anyone who is born again understands that their condition, apart from Jesus Christ, is that they are utterly lost and without hope. And it's the word that reveals that to us. But it's also the word that reveals to us, those who have trusted Christ now, who we are in Christ. And we recognize that apart from Christ, boy, there'd be no hope for us at all. And so he just kind of nails the Pharisees. Verse 20, these words he spoke in the treasury, and that's a portion there that was located on the temple grounds, as he taught in the temple. But no one arrested him because his hour had not come. If you'd remember, the Pharisees had sent those there to arrest Jesus, but they were not able to arrest him because his hour had not yet come. You see, man can devise all kinds of plans, but it's God alone who is sovereign, and all time, as we know it, is in his hands. Verse 21, so he said to them again, I am going away, and you will seek me, and you will die in your sins. Where I am going, you cannot come. You see, the reality is that if one does not trust Christ, if they don't place their trust in Christ, they will die in their sin. Now, it's appointed to every man to be born and a day to die. And the Bible says, after that day of death, then comes judgment. And there's no hope for one who has died without Christ. There's no hope of trying to go to him afterwards. The Catholic Church has that doctrine of purgatory, which is just not biblical at all, that there's a holding place and we can somehow or another pray those into heaven who have died on and have not trusted Christ. Listen, there's no hope. And we're going to see Sunday morning in the story of Lazarus and the rich man that once that day comes for an individual, that is really their day of judgment. If they've not trusted Christ, they will die and they will spend an eternity separated from God in hell. But only those who have trusted Christ, not because of their own merits, not because of their own worth, they will inherit eternal life in the everlasting kingdom of God. So he said to him, I'm going, where I'm going, you cannot come. The Jews said, will he kill himself since he says, where I'm going, you not come? They didn't understand. Then in verse 23, he said to them, you are from below, I am from above. You are of this world, and I am not of this world. I told you that you would die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. Meaning, you'll die judged by the reality that you are a sinner, and you sin because you're a sinner, and you're separated from me. You see, they thought that they had the kingdom of heaven by inheritance. They thought because they were the sons of Abraham, that they were the Jews, that they just had a shoe in. But listen, the gospel declares that unless one is born again, unless one trusts Christ, they will not inherit eternal life. Jesus said to them, just what I have been telling you after they asked him, who are you? Just what I have been telling you from the beginning. I have much to say about you and much to judge, but he who sent me is true, and I declare to the world what I have heard from him. They did not understand that he had been speaking up to them about the Father. So Jesus said to them, listen to this, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing on my own authority, but speak just as the Father taught me. and he who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do the things that are pleasing to him. Jesus is speaking of his crucifixion, when they will lift him up on the cross, when the Jews will crucify him. On that day, you'll recognize and realize who I am, because of the events that would take place, and he would in fact raise from the dead. And one can deny it. One can act as if it isn't true. It doesn't. It didn't take place. But they all knew in their hearts that Jesus had in fact risen from the dead. You see, our salvation depends on Christ going to the cross, God, the very Son of God, going to the cross, making atonement, making a payment for our sins by his shed blood, and that he would have our sins placed on him when he was on the cross, that the wrath of God, the judgment of God, would be enacted on him rather than us. That's the substitutionary atonement that we speak of, that doctrine, that he was a substitute for us, and that he bore God's wrath so that we wouldn't have to if we placed our trust in Christ, and that he must be buried and then raised again from the third day, conquering death, not only physical death, but spiritual death as well. The question is, have you placed your trust solely on Jesus this morning? If I were to ask you, why would God let you into heaven? And if your answer is anything other than, because Jesus went to the cross and paid the penalty for my sins, and I've trusted in that. If your answer is anything else, chances are you've not trusted Christ and been born again. I want to invite you this morning to place your trust in Christ. I also want to invite you this morning, if you know that you've placed your trust in Christ, that you're born again, then be about the gospel mission. Pray and ask God for an opportunity today to plant a seed of the gospel in somebody's heart. And if you recognize the gospel's been planted, that you would have the wisdom and discernment to know how to cultivate that seed, and pray and believe God to save that person, that we might share in his miraculous work of salvation. Well, I pray the Lord blesses you today. He keeps you. I want to encourage you to be present this Sunday morning. We are having a communion together as a body. If you're not able to be physically with us, then tune in, maybe get the elements before the service. And it can really be anything as an element. It doesn't have to be juice and it doesn't have to be bread. But there's that heart matter in communion with him and reflecting on what a great, 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 great gift he has given us in salvation through Christ. And that is the covenant relationship sealed by his blood. So be with us this Sunday morning as we partake of communion together as a body. Encourage, invite somebody to come along with you. Share Christ with others. I love you. I pray the Lord's blessings on you, that he keep you. Have a great day.